Okay, so I'll be talking about this topic, heart-lung interactions. So this is a physiological topic, so extremely useful for all intensive care trainees, because this forms the essence of understanding the complex pathophysiological aspects that happen in various disease conditions in more so mechanically ventilated patients. So I think this would be a little dry topic, but I've tried to simplify as much as I can. So I think the first thing we need to understand is what are the determinants of heart-lung. I think throughout this talk, you will be seeing that I'll be talking about a volume and pressure, because whatever interactions happen between heart and lung, it is to do with the volumes that are delivered and with regards to the pressure changes that are happening within the body. So the main determinant would be the lung volume. So you would see more and more at the end of it, you would realize it's the volume which has more detrimental bearing on heart-lung interactions as opposed to the pressure. So obviously both have bearing. So lung volume, because this has a direct bearing on the transpulmonary pressure. Then you have this intrathoracic pressure, which constitutes pleural pressure and pericardial pressure. So these are the key variables which have a complex interplay in various conditions. So basically, we need to understand when patient is breathing spontaneously, there is a reduction in the intrathoracic pressure. But when you put this patient on controlled ventilation, intermittent positive pressure ventilation, so your intrathoracic pressure increases. So that is something we need to understand. And these changes have a direct bearing with regards to the lung volume. So increase in the lung volume, the effects will be a lot more profound. And the varying lung volumes have different hemodynamic response in spontaneously breathing patients and different hemodynamic response in ventilated patients. So what you need to understand is it's the lung volumes which has a profound bearing on the hemodynamic response and consequently the intrathoracic pressure also. So, and these changes, whatever changes we are talking, happens with every breath. And these changes are different during inspiration, and these changes are different during expiration. So this is what is the challenge that we face in a mechanical ventilation. Especially if they're spontaneously breathing, then the inspiratory breath also has a profound bearing as opposed to expiratory. If it is completely controlled, then your inspiratory and expiratory breaths may have a little less bearing. So that's why it needs to be extremely important whether patient is breathing spontaneously or patient is in complete controlled mechanical ventilation, because everywhere the changes are different. And with every breath, so the more unwell the patient is, more critically unwell, these every breath-to-breath changes is a lot more profound in mechanically ventilated patients. So we need to understand whenever there is a concomitant presence of lung disease for which patient is intubated or mechanically ventilated, there is increase in the stress. And this compounded by cardiovascular disease, so this compensatory response or the response would be even more profound. So when you have a concomitant presence of the lung disease along with cardiac disease or one disease with another normal organ, so the effect will be a lot more profound, because the compensatory response that you would expect would get compromised, and then you would have more hemodynamic sort of changes or response to disease pattern. So, and in the heart-lung interaction, so basically any hypoxemia in the lung, I think what we need to understand is it can lead to cardiovascular collapse. And this cardiovascular collapse can also, and along with it, there can be increased in the pulmonary vascular resistance. And this is significantly accentuated by hyperinflation causing hypercapnia, or you have this lung collapse or any of these situations. So basically hypoxemia can have a bearing on cardiovascular collapse, and then if you have any hypercapnia or atelectasis collapse, so it has a profound bearing on increasing the pulmonary vascular resistance. So this is something which have a direct correlation. So now we look into what are the steps that one could take to limit or overcome the detrimental effects of the heart-lung interactions that you just saw. So what is mentioned is there are few things we need to bear in mind as the steps that one could take to minimize that heart-lung interaction. So what is mentioned is when someone is in a controlled mechanical ventilation, then the fluid resuscitation has a positive bearing, has a favorable effect. But when you are weaning the patient from a mechanical ventilator, then any fluid resuscitation would have a detrimental bearing, because we are spontaneously breathing. and they would tend to have a detrimental bearing. So these are some of the broader things that you can keep in mind. When in a weaning phase, fluid resuscitation to be avoided. But when you have initiated ventilation, fluid response has a favorable effect. These are all general broader aspects of it. And try to minimize negative swings of intrathoracic pressure. And whenever someone is mechanically ventilated, steps should be to augment myocardial contractility. Because the contractility also gets affected. There can be some bearing on the myocardial dysfunction that can set in. And effort should be to reduce the work of breathing, because work of breathing has a negative bearing on the cardiopulmonary interactions. And another important thing when someone is ventilated is to prevent hyperinflation of the lung. Because as you saw, hyperinflation of the lung can increase the pulmonary vascular resistance and it can lead to problems. So I think steps have to be taken to minimize hyperinflation or over distension of the lungs. That's why there is a lot of emphasis on the volume aspect, because the more tidal volumes, I will show, which you will see in the subsequent slides, has a negative bearing. So now what about the effect of lung volume and autonomic tone? So it has been found if you are ventilating a patient with tidal volume less than 10 ml per kg, there is a withdrawal of the vagal tone and there is increase in the heart rate. So this is a response of a patient during ventilation when you are ventilating at a lower tidal volume. But what happens if you are ventilating at a tidal volume of more than 15 ml per kg, which in this day and age we wouldn't be ventilating anyone at this. So the response you would see is there is increase in the vagal tone plus sympathetic withdrawal and there is bradycardic response. So this is the effect of varying tidal volume on the heart lung. So lower tidal volume can sort of have a tachycardic effect due to the vagal tone. This is at a physiological level. And if you supranormal tidal volumes can cause bradycardia by increasing vagal tone. So and there are certain hormonal effects also which has a bearing on heart lung interactions, because the right atrium functions as the body's effective indicator for circulating blood volume. It's a sensor for the circulating blood volume. So when you are positively, when you are on a controlled mechanical ventilation, there is reduced stretch on the right atrium. And what it leads to, because of the stretching of the right atrium, so there is reduced production of atrial natriuretic peptide. Because of this reduction of natriuretic, because the function of natriuretic peptide is to cause diuresis. Because there is a stretch in positive pressure ventilation on this, because of reduced production, they retain a lot of fluid. That is why we often see that patients who are mechanically ventilated tend to retain fluid, and that's why they put on weight. So there is increase in the body weight due to retention of fluid, and one of the proposed mechanism is because of the stretch of these receptors on the right atrium and reduced production of ANP. So what basically these slides are showing you is there is always an interaction, and this interaction is multimodal. So there is volume effect, and I'll talk about pressure effect, there is hormonal effect, and there is lung factors and there are cardiac factors. So basically these are all have a complex interplay, and we need to have some sense as to how to keep all this within normal physiological range so that we minimize these detrimental effects. So I think this is an important diagram for you to understand. So they have looked at the pleural pressure in various areas where they are ventilated. So what they have found is the pleural pressure from the anterior, on the anterior surface of the lung, is usually same from apex to the bottom. But the highest pleural pressures are found in the posterior aspect of the pleura. So as you see, the posterior gutter pleural pressure is always more than anterior pleural pressure. And the pleural pressures are maximum at the juxtacardiac. So around the heart, the pleural pressures are very high. And this also has a bearing. So basically, the highest pleural pressures are seen around the heart and posterior aspect. Anterior aspect is less, and that's why in ARDS there is a lot more emphasis on posterior lungs, posterior basal aspects, because anterior is not significantly affected in the pathology. So for all our intensive care trainees, lateral wall is least affected with lung complaints. So the most significant is the posterior and the juxtacardiac areas. So and the diaphragmatic also is least affected for diaphragmatic wall. So we need to remember the posterior pleural pressure and the juxtacardiac pleural pressure are the highest usually, and they are the ones we tend to have bearing. So that's about, so we spoke about tidal volume effect, we spoke about hormonal effects, we spoke about certain lung mechanics. Now we'll get into the alveoli. So I think what is important in heart-lung interaction is we have seen that right heart gets affected and pulmonary vascular resistance is what gets significantly affected. So there's, when you talk about heart-lung interaction, there's a lot of emphasis on pulmonary vascular resistance. So why does that get affected? Because it gets affected at two levels. One gets affected at a micro level, which is at an alveolar level. So alveolar level, basically because of increased volume, so this alveolar pressure can increase. So that is affected by, we call it as a transmural pressure, which is a difference between alveolar pressure and intramural pressure. So basically because of increased volume, I'll show the next figure, these alveolar vessels get constricted because of the volume, they get collapsed. And because of that, the pressure increases and that increases the pulmonary vascular rate. This happens at an alveolar level. What happens at the extra-alveolar level? Extra-alveolar vessels, it has a bearing on the large pulmonary arteries, veins, heart and lungs. So basically, the influence of it, you call it as transmural pressure, which is equal to intramural pressure minus intrathoracic pressure. So at alveolar level, it is the alveolar pressure which contributes to pulmonary vascular resistance. At the macro level, at the large vessel level, it is the intrathoracic pressure which has a bearing on pulmonary vascular resistance. I'll show the next figure, you'll understand. So basically, this slide is showing you that the increase in the pulmonary vascular resistance is happening due to the pathology that lies at the alveolar level and due to the overall intrathoracic pressure which tends to go up in various disease conditions. So this is what you need. So it's micro level and macro level, there are factors which influence the pulmonary vascular resistance. So this figure is extremely important, you will understand. See, on the y-axis you will see pulmonary vascular resistance and this is the lung volume. So that's why we are talking about how lung volume has an important bearing on the hypoxic pulmonary vessels. See, this red one is the pulmonary vascular resistance. As you see, the lung volume keeps increasing, as you see here. So alveolar compression happens. The more volume, the alveolar vessels get compressed. So your pulmonary hypoxic vasoconstriction keeps increasing. So as you see, the resistance, pulmonary vascular resistance keeps increasing with increase in the tidal volumes or lung volumes. Okay. And what happens at alveolar vessels? See, as you see, this is the alveolar vessels, the purple one. The alveolar vessels also collapse when there is more lung expansion, lung volume. And that also leads to pulmonary vascular resistance. And what happens to this atelectasis? When there is atelectasis, this green one is extra-alveolar vessels. So there is, during atelectasis, even at low volume, there is pulmonary hypoxic vasoconstriction. Even at high volumes, it continues. So basically, atelectasis is bad through and through. Even at a micro level, at macro level, it causes pulmonary hypoxic vasoconstriction. So what is the best phase we should look at? We should look at this functional residual capacity at which pulmonary vascular resistance is least, not functional residual capacity. So this figure pretty much summarizes the previous slide and the two slides before, that how at every level your volume has a detrimental. That's why I said at the outset of the talk, the volume more than pressure has a bearing on your hypoxic pulmonary vasoconstrictions at the micro level and at macro level. So then we'll talk about pulmonary vascular resistance, because the heart-lung interactions, the whole emphasis is on right heart and your pulmonary vascular resistance. So pulmonary vascular resistance is mean pulmonary artery pressure minus mean arterial wedge pressure, pulmonary artery wedge pressure divided by cardiac output. So I'm sure all of our intensive care trainees would know. So basically your pulmonary vascular resistance is indicator of your RV afterload. So what they found is the changes in intrathoracic pressure without change in lung volume. So understand this. So there is a change in intrathoracic pressure. When there is change pressure without change in lung volume, does not affect pulmonary vascular resistance. So that's what it means. So which means to say, it is again the volume which contributes significantly to change in the pulmonary vascular resistance. So that's what this is telling you. So because if it's only pressure, it's not. That's why there is so much emphasis in ARDS, because in ARDS, if you do not take care of this pulmonary vascular resistance, then your RV afterload increases later and they'll go into RV failure. So that is why our whole concept of ARDS is to limit this lung volume, so that your lung volume is kept at minimum and this pulmonary vascular resistance, which is a cumulative effect that we see, is mitigated. And pulmonary vascular resistance can go up due to hyperinflation of the lung. Again, so our whole intent is to avoid volutrauma, hyperinflation, and at the same time, make sure your hypoxic vasoconstriction, hypoxic pulmonary vasoconstriction also is avoided. So you have to avoid hypoxia, you have to avoid lung overinflation, and you have to avoid a lot of lung volume because all these are bad for pulmonary vascular resistance. So this is what we understand. So as you see, again the reiterate, changes in lung volume directly alter pulmonary vasomotor by compressing alveoles. So you'll time and again you'll see, that's why in intensive care we have come to a conclusion that it's not the pressure which is harmful, it is more of volume, because even at a micro level, volume seems to be playing a detrimental role. I think this figure will clearly tell you. So when alveolus is sort of over distended, you have these alveolar vessels which get compressed. And I think if you have seen my previous ARDS slide, you would understand this concept very well. During inspiration, this effect is a lot more because you are adding inspiratory pressure. You add pressure support if you add. So that obviously increases your transpulmonary pressure more. So as I said, in inspiration, transpulmonary pressure is greater than in expiration. So that's why the detrimental effects is more during inspiration. During inspiration, alveoli, the transpulmonary pressure increases, your alveolar distension is more and pulmonary vascular resistance is more. So this is why this figure, if you keep in mind, you would understand. So see, again it says high lung volume more than FRC, your alveolar vessels compressed, increase in PVI. I think this is the crux or essence of heart-lung interactions, you need to understand. So again you see transpulmonary pressure. I think transpulmonary pressure is simply your mean airway pressure minus pleural pressure. So here they have very figuratively shown, if your atmospheric pressure is 760, okay, this 760 is transmitted to this alveolar, so which is called alveolar pressure, and your pleural pressure is generally minus 4, as you see. So basically your transpulmonary pressure becomes 4 here. So this is a simplified physiological understanding. Basically you have to negate alveolar pressure, so which is 760, then you minus pleural pressure, so then you get what is called as, because the pleural pressure you see here is 756, and you get the transpulmonary pressure of 4 millimeter mercury. So this, I think if you have seen my ARDS slide, you'll understand during inspiration and expiration how these have an interplay in ventilated patients and spontaneously breathing patients. So again here, so this is a slide again to show the relationship of pleural pressure, airway pressure and lung volume. See, again this slide reiterates, your lung volumes keeps increasing. So lung volume has a direct bearing on pleural pressure also. See, your pleural pressure also starts increasing. You see this. So what that means is, if pleural pressure keeps increasing, then obviously your transpulmonary pressure also there can go up. So the changes in the pleural pressure has a direct correlation in the changes in the lung volume. See, as you see, when the lung volume in acute lung injury, so this is an acute lung injury, as the lung volume increases, your transpulmonary pressure keeps increasing. So that's why in ARDS our whole concept is, we keep the lung volume low and reduce this transpulmonary pressure. So the change in the pleural pressure has a direct correlation to the lung volume, but does not have correlation with changes in the airway pressure. So again, this slide again reiterates how volume has more detrimental bearing on pleural pressure. So the previous slides we saw how lung volume has a detrimental effect on the pulmonary vascular resistance. These two slides are showing you how your lung volume has a bearing on increasing in the pleural pressure and not change in the airway pressure. Okay, so again it says airway pressure has no significant effect on intrathoracic pressure. So now this slide basically reiterates the effect of all these pressure changes on the CVP. So what they found is less than 50% of the PEEP is reflected on CVP. So basically whatever PEEP you said, we know the CVP is underestimated. So it is postulated that less than 50% of the PEEP is reflected on CVP, just if you are doing CVP monitoring, which we seldom do now. So if your CVP is 2.5, your CVP is reflected as 1.5 millimeter mercury. So that is something. So we finished the effects of volume on PVR, pulmonary vascular resistance. So we saw how your lung volume has an effect on the pleural pressure. By having an effect on the pleural pressure, how your transpulmonary pressure also tends to increase because of the volume. And then we saw the CVP. Now we look into the RV afterload. So what do we understand by right ventricular afterload? So right ventricular afterload is maximum RV systolic wall stress. So what do we understand by that? So we understand this by Laplace's law, which basically tells it is a product of radius of the curvature in which systolic wall stress is happening and transmural pressure. So basically you have a ventricle, you take the radius of that ventricle and the transmural pressure, pressure gradient across the ventricle. So if you are taking pulmonary, transmural pulmonary artery pressure, so it is basically you will, it's a product of this radius and the pressure across the gradient. So when there is increase in the transmural pulmonary artery pressure, so when there is an increase, so what it leads, if there is basically an increase in the pulmonary artery pressure, there is increase in the afterload. So just imagine that pulmonary artery pressure is high, so there is increase in the afterload, then there can be, if there is an acute increase, there can be RV dilatation and there can be reduced RV stroke volume. So these are the effects of acute rise in pulmonary artery pressure or acute rise in pulmonary vascular resistance. What you could expect is RV afterload increases and RV stroke volume comes down, and if it's an acute, there can be. So this is what we see as a sequelae of possibly acute ARDS or acute respiratory failure. RV has effect, so RV gets dysfunctional. So that is something we need to understand. So acute corpulmonale is something that can manifest when these heart-lung interactions become profound because of volume, because of pleural pressure, and because of the other changes that I mentioned. So as you see on RV, basically there is an increased pressure on the vena cava and there is a increase in the ITP, which has basically reduces the venous return and the detrimental effects. And there is a concept of ventricular interdependence. When there is increased RV volume, it can affect your LV compliance by ventricular interdependence. What it means is because there is an RV overload, so there is a strain on the LV and there is a movement of the septum to the left and acute RV dilatation. So this we call it as ventricular interdependence, and this leads to LV dysfunction. So this happens as a sequelae of RV afterload increasing, RV stroke volume coming down, and your interventricular septum moving into the left side and LV function also compromised. So basically your RV failure which set in ultimately will lead to the LV dysfunction. So RV dysfunction leading to the LV dysfunction, we call it as ventricular interdependence. So the most common manifestation of this is pulsus paradoxus in clinical parlance. Okay, so that's about all the changes that happen because of heart-lung interactions in ventilated patients. So in these situations, as an intensivist, we are meant to ascertain your fluid responsiveness. So that is why our understanding of volume heart-lung interaction is important. So how do we assess fluid responsiveness? By understanding this concept of heart-lung is, we can estimate dynamic estimates of preload, because the pulse pressure variation, what we look at as an estimate of fluid responsiveness is heart-lung interactions. You are basically capturing the heart-lung interactions, quantifying it, and say they are fluid responsive. So basically in intermittent or controlled mechanical ventilation, there is cyclical changes in the arterial blood pressure. And these cyclical changes, why does the cyclical changes happen? Because it is a cumulative effect. It is a reflection of your venous return, right ventricular, RV venous return, intrathoracic blood volume, and RV stroke volume or RV ejection. So I think these three influence your cyclical change in the arterial pressure. So venous return, intrathoracic blood volume, and the RV ejection. So if any of these is affected, obviously this will have a bearing on your cyclical changes. So this is what we look at as pulse pressure variation and determine whatever number we agree upon as fluid responsiveness. I think Frank Sterling, most of the intensive care trainees would know, because we know this is important to determine, because we need to ascertain which part of this curve patient is in to determine that patients are fluid responsive. We know that in the ascending limb is what we know is fluid responsiveness. So once you go here, they become non-responsive, because this is estimate of ventricular pull load. So you keep giving fluid, so there is increase in the stroke volume on y-axis, but after some stage it plateaus. So a patient is volume responsive only if both ventricles are in steep portion of the curve, basically here, and response depends on contractility and afterload, which was shown in the previous figure. It depends on your whole RV ejection, depends on your preload, which is your venous return, your intrathoracic blood volume, and contractility or RV stroke volume. So that's what this figure represents. And I told you what is applied importance of understanding heart-lung interaction is clinically, how do we determine that? By doing this pulse pressure variation. So we determine the patient is fluid responsive when there is obvious too much variation in the pulse pressure. Here we look at what aspect? Hypovolemia, we look at the delta down during expiration. So during expiration, we look at the delta down, and then that is captured and that is shown as pulse pressure variation, which we quantify and take it as indicator of patients who are responsive. So I think what we are basically trying to say is whatever physiology of heart-lung interaction we have understood, we try to apply practically to determine which patients are fluid responsive by understanding this concept. Okay, then we'll talk about pathophysiology of weaning, which again is a reflection of your heart-lung interactions. So weaning is associated with greater swings in intrathoracic pressure. So when you are weaning, when I say when you are weaning, it means you are making patients spontaneously breathe. So when that is happening, there is increase in the preload, because when this is typically you will see in cardiac patients, when we are weaning, when we make them breathe on their own and reduce the pressure support or PEEP, then it is called as a challenge. It is called as a cardiac challenge or cardiac stress test. So we increase the preload because your venous return may increase and afterload also increases. There is an increase in the sympathetic surge. There's increased work of breathing, and actually there can be reduced mixed venous oxygenation. So these are the results, and we call weaning should be considered as cardiovascular stress test, because when you make them breathe spontaneously and take them out from the controlled mechanical ventilation, all those physiological changes will be undone and you will see there is a profound shift. Obviously, when you are ventilating, there is reduction in the preload, reduction in afterload. Here everything gets opposite, and this creates tremendous stress on the heart. That's why this applies more so in cardiac patients where contractility is affected. That's why they say weaning is considered as a cardiovascular stress test in most patients. Especially in myocardial dysfunction patients, this becomes a huge stress. So that's what we need to understand. So the conclusions, so the transmission of airway pressure to intrathoracic pressure is highly variable and unpredictable. As you see, we saw in broad sense how they are related to each other, and every disease has a different bearing. But I think whatever has been narrated remains the core essence of the interactions that happen. And mechanical properties of lung, I think that is very important, affects the cardiopulmonary interaction. When I say mechanical properties, it can be iatrogenic. It is the amount of volume we deliver to the patient, or the hyperinflation of the lung that may be happening, or atelectasis that may be happening as a part of pathology or pleural pathology. All these have a bearing on cardiovascular function by increasing pulmonary vascular resistance or transpulmonary pressure and so on and so forth. And respiratory, and how is it important to understand heart-lung? Because it is important to understand heart-lung interaction to determine who are fluid responsive by ascertaining the pulse pressure variation, which is an indicator of your venous return, intrathoracic blood pressure and right ventricular function, because right ventricular function is directly related to your pulmonary vascular resistance as well. So all these are interlinked, and pulse pressure variation causes decrease in preload, and positive pressure ventilation causes decrease in preload and afterload, favorable for failing heart, because as I said, in failing heart it may be favorable, and which is afterload sensitive. And weaning should be considered as cardiovascular. So weaning, especially in myocardial dysfunction, you would all agree that we have to undertake this with lot of supervision and vigilance, because patients can go into pulmonary edema when you are weaning in the setting of a low myocardial function. So thank you very much. So that is in essence heart-lung interaction. So if you understand this much, I think you pretty much understand the basic tenets of how these heart-lung interactions happen. So if there are any more detailing in this, possibly I will do it in my subsequent talks. But whatever we read in heart-lung interaction, everything revolves around these aspects. One about the physiological aspects, how heart-lungs interact, and pathological, when cardiac dysfunction is present, how they interact, when lung dysfunction or when lung pathology, how they dysfunction. That is second aspect. Third aspect is therapeutic effect, looking at fluid responsive. So this is all it is, how much ever you go around it. So if any of you ask me any other details in this, maybe I'll cover in subsequent videos.